Hi, and welcome everyone to another edition of our webinar series, Navigating the Just Transition. Today, we discuss the importance of gender in the context of just transition. I am Dan Dobre from CE Bankwatch. I am a just transition campaigner and working on this for a few years now. Today, I have with me three panelists, Jill Alwood, who is a professor of gender and politics at Nottingham Trent University from the UK, Tudorina Mihai, the president of Front Feminist in Romania, and Alma Midžić, independent researcher from Bosnia and Herzegovina. So just a bit of context, we discuss just transition. When we discuss just transition, we always talk about reshaping carbon intensive regions. And I think this is a really good moment to rethink also other structures of society, not only carbon intensive industries. We know that the process needs to be inclusive. And we know that in the past, the focus was mostly on men working in these polluting industries. The focus on men and reskilling men, which was most of the focus in the past, sometimes failed. So we need the transition efforts to go beyond just focusing on men in these carbon intensive industries. Looking forward, we need to have a more broad spectrum of stakeholders in order to ensure the successful transition. What we're going to do today is focus on the gender dimension of the just transition. We will have three parts. The first part will be a theoretical overview of the link between just transition and gender, and also the situation across Europe. We will look at two examples of two countries. One is Romania, and we will look on how the just transition process has been connected, and how drafting up TJTPs in Romania have included the gender dimension. And also we will look at the situation in Bosnia and Herzegovina and the contribution of local activists in the just transition process. So without a long introduction, I will just want to tell you that to everyone joining online, we encourage you to engage and ask questions towards the speakers. And don't forget to mention, if you have a question directly towards someone, to mention for whom the question is for. Please, Jill, you can start talking about the general context and the theoretical framework that we are trying to have this discussion in. And I'm sure you can do a better introduction than I can, so feel free.
Thank you, Dan, and welcome everyone. So my work is focused on the EU, and it looks at the European Green Deal and the just transition from a gender perspective. And today I'm going to talk about some research that I did for FEPS, which was produced in two policy briefs. And the link will be in the chat so that you can access those if you are interested. So just transition in a European context has largely been about redistributing the burden of the decarbonisation process across the regions. And as Dan said, about moving men from carbon intensive jobs into alternative forms of employment. It hasn't really been about looking at how the transition affects the whole community, how the community could benefit from the opportunities presented by the transition, and how all members of the community can be involved in shaping the transition. And gender, as I and many others have argued, has been almost completely ignored. This is both disappointing and surprising, not least because a commitment to a union of equality was announced as one of the Commission's top priorities at the same time as the European Green Deal was launched in 2019. So why does it matter that the European Green Deal and the just transition are gender blind? When approaches to issues ignore gender, they tend to reinforce existing inequalities, but also produce new inequalities. And gender is clearly not the only inequality, but it is one of the most persistent and one of the most widespread. So last year, a UN women report noted that it would take 300 years to achieve gender equality at the current rate of progress. And in the EU, we see in the annual Gender Equality Index reports from the European Institute for Gender Equality that gender equality is progressing very slowly, and in some cases, it's even stalling or regressing. The Gender Equality Index shows that the regions targeted by just transition measures are those where gender inequality tends to be the most pronounced. And so this connection between just transition and eradicating gender inequalities becomes very acute. So what do we do? I argue that it's important that we revisit the concept of mainstreaming. So we've all become very familiar with the idea that some problems can't be solved in policy silos, but that they need a coherent and a holistic approach. And climate change is one such issue. Climate change can't be solved by a separate department or a separate ministry, which is responsible simply for addressing the problem of climate change while everything else continues as normal. It has to be embraced as a problem which needs to be addressed by everybody, so that all departments, all ministries, all actors act together in order to pursue the same common objective. This is very clearly stated in the European Green Deal. The European Green Deal explicitly states that climate change is a cross-cutting issue and that it requires a holistic approach. There's a common aim, a common objective, which is achieving carbon neutrality by 2050. And there are interim targets of reductions in greenhouse gas emissions, for example, by 2030. And the European Green Deal tells us that all policies in all sectors must align with these targets, must work together towards these same objectives. And this is referred to as climate mainstreaming. Climate mainstreaming is the idea that all actors work together towards climate objectives. And climate mainstreaming, interestingly, is funded. It's supported by appropriate resources. 30% of expenditure is allocated to reaching European Green Deal targets in the EU's budget. So this is great. It's clearly very important that climate action is mainstreamed throughout all EU actions. But when climate mainstreaming is referred to, it leads me to ask, whatever happened to gender mainstreaming? Gender mainstreaming was first introduced in the 1990s. It was introduced at the fourth UN Conference on Women in Beijing in 1995, and it was very soon adopted by the European Union. Gender mainstreaming was a truly radical approach, and it has huge transformative potential. The idea of gender mainstreaming was to ensure that a commitment to gender equality is fully integrated at all stages of policy making, from problem definition and policy formulation through implementation to impact and evaluation, and in all policy issue areas. So not just those which are obviously gendered, like maternity leave and women's employment, but those which are less obviously gendered, for example, trade, security, energy, transport, industry, and many others. Despite the fact that the EU is an early adopter of gender mainstreaming and has reiterated its commitment ever since, numerous studies have shown that gender mainstreaming is often seen as a tick box exercise, and that much policymaking continues as though gender has nothing to do with it. Gender mainstreaming needs to be done properly. It needs to be done thoroughly throughout all areas of policymaking, and it incorporates all kinds of ways of ensuring that gender equality is correctly integrated. So this includes, for example, gender analyses, ex-ante gender impact assessments and gender budgeting. What it doesn't mean is adding gender onto policies which are already fully formed, already formulated. Also, gender mainstreaming requires resources. Remember that climate mainstreaming comes with 30% of the EU's budget. Gender equality has been identified by the EU's Court of Auditors as the cross-cutting issue which is the least well mainstreamed into EU policymaking and which has the fewest resources to support it. So in the context of the EU's commitment to gender equality and its repeated statement of commitment to gender mainstreaming as a way of achieving it, it's difficult to imagine that a policy framework as overarching and as cross-cutting as the European Green Deal was presented in a gender-blind fashion. But this is exactly what happened. So gender equality is almost entirely absent from the European Green Deal. And the just transition has been similarly presented in a gender-blind fashion. So references to a just transition are still largely about how to find new employment for men in carbon-intensive sectors. And when there are references to social justice, it's largely at the household level. For example, when talking about energy poverty, it's presented as inequalities in access to energy according to household. And this obscures the gender differences within those households and also gender differences across households. We are now seeing signs of gender being tacked on to discussions about the just transition. And of course, this is to be welcomed. But it's such hard work to gender policies that are already formulated and which have been formulated in a gender-blind fashion. Gender mainstreaming was the radical transformative alternative to this, integrating gender equality into all policies at all stages, including from the very outset, so that the amazing practitioners and activists on the ground, including those at Bankwatch, including many of you who are in the audience today, don't have to start from scratch every single time. So we need to take deliberate measures to bring about change. It's not going to happen by some kind of natural evolution. Gender equality needs to be explicitly included in policies, in programs and projects. Otherwise, gender inequalities, which are deeply embedded in social norms, practices and institutions, will persist. The transition to carbon neutrality is absolutely an opportunity to address existing inequalities, not just gender inequalities, but intersecting inequalities, whether these are based on region, ethnicity, physical ability, age, or others. This is stated very clearly in the section of Fit for 55, one of the central EU policy documents as part of the European Green Deal. This section of the document is entitled A Socially Fair Transition, and it states the transition towards climate neutrality can be a unique opportunity to reduce systemic inequality. This is important, it's a very clear, explicit, and powerful statement, but it completely ignores gender. The transition to carbon neutrality is then an opportunity to address gender and other inequalities, but it can't be an add-on. It has to be designed into the plan during the formulation stage. The just transition is an opportunity not to be missed, and that's why I'm so interested to hear from our next speakers about the work that they're doing to see a truly just transition realised. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jill. Yeah, I'm also looking forward to the next speakers. But before that, I would like to, because I said this in the introduction regarding how just transition was viewed as reskilling men in regions. And you also mentioned this, but I was wondering, is that enough just to move more women into green jobs? Would that solve the problem?
it's not going to solve the problem on its own. Of course, it's important. Of course, inequalities in employment are a very pressing problem and have been throughout the whole efforts to achieve gender equality. The gender pay gap in the EU is very sticky. It's very resistant to change. It's still present. I think it's around 25%. And in some regions, it's much larger than in others. Women are concentrated in particular sectors. So there's horizontal segregation of women's labor. And they also tend to be concentrated at the bottom of the hierarchy in all sectors. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done there. But focusing on the number of women isn't enough if we are going to see a truly transformative transition. So it's important that we stress that gender is not just about women. When we're talking about gender and the just transition, we are not simply talking about women and green employment. Also, women are not homogenous. So there are vast differences between the experiences of women who are working in DG Clima and the European Commission, for example, and women who are working in just transition regions where they are embedded in the community, which is experiencing the problems associated with decarbonisation. There is a very, it's very important to focus on the broader experiences of women in their communities. Then this includes revaluing care and the invisible as well as the visible care labour that tends to be done by women. But it also means looking at health and education and violence as well as employment. So we need a much more rounded approach to the question of gender and the just transition, rather than focusing simply on counting the number of women in green jobs.
Thanks, Jill. It's actually on point with one of the things that we knew theoretically, that women's issues are social issues in general. And I think in practice, we also find this a lot. We know the theory, but practice also tells us it's actually spot on. So that's very interesting. Thank you so much for the overview. It's obvious that now we know why it's crucial to talk about gender when we talk about just transition. So after this, I think it's good to go into a practical example of Romania and how the drafting of the TJTPs worked with regard to the gender dimension. So Tudorina, please.
Can you hear me?
Sure.
Yes. And I would like to show you my presentation on the screen. Can you see it? Yes? Can you see my presentation? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dan. And thank you very much, Jill, for your introduction. Very, very good point. And so we'll, I think, be useful for my next presentation. I will talk about the results of the project we have been running since last year in partnership with Bankwatch Romania. Front Feminist from Romania, which is a feminist association. The project name was Integrating Women from Jiu Valley in the Just Transition Process. Jiu Valley is a mining region in Romania, which is part of Hunedoara County, one of the counties benefiting from European funds from the Just Transition Fund. As Jill already said, in general, studies and projects regarding just transition are focused on minors or men, especially ignoring lives of women. So this is why we considered our project as pioneer and also important in Romania. In our project, we started from the principle mentioned in the European Green Pact, no one should be left behind, which is also an UN principle, as we know. and from the reality that the most vulnerable are those most exposed to the harmful effects of climate change and environmental degradation. The text of the Green Pact recognizes that the transition can only be successful if it's carried out in an equal and inclusive way. So our project last year had two components. One component consisted in a research, and the second one was advocacy campaign. A few words about the research. The research was carried out over a period of 3 months by the researchers Elena Trifan and Madalina Musca. And they try to collect information through on-site interviews on the social and working condition of women living in Jiu Valley. You have the link to the research, I guess, in the chat. If not, I will give you at the end of this presentation. This research shows that the economic effects of the unplanned transition have affected family life, where women play the main role, but also the quality of life more generally. Women have been adding extra paid labor tasks without taking the pressure of domestic work off their shoulders. The women interviewed in the research stressed that Jiu Valley lacks basic family support services, such as extended daycare centers, after-school care, or school integration programs. Women also complained about the scarcity of medical services, including those dedicated to childbirth or childcare, as well as for the elderly in the area. The researchers showed that women problems are having an impact on the society as a whole, leading to migration abroad or to other more economically stable regions in Romania. We also included at the end of this research some recommendations. You can see them on the screen. I'm not going to read all the recommendations. After we launched this research, we started the advocacy component of the project. In this part, I had the opportunity to work together with my colleague, Carmen Radu, and also with Dan Dobre, our guest today from Bankwatch Romania. In this first phase of the advocacy campaign, we had meetings with local NGOs and local and county government representatives. This was actually a very important part of the advocacy campaign because we wanted to find out the realities from Jiu Valley directly from people involved at the local level. What we saw during this meeting was that, and we already somehow know, was that there were no local NGOs working specifically in promoting women's rights and gender equality. And at the county level, there were few services from victims, survivors of domestic violence. But in Jiu Valley, there were no such services, and they are not even now. We were actually having, we had good meetings with the local and county authorities. But we realized at that point of our campaign that we cannot rely in the local and county budget to make some changes in the social sphere of the Jiu Valley. One important conclusion that emerged from our dialogue with authorities and NGO was that women's problems are part of a wider picture of social problems faced by people in former mono-industrial regions like Jiu Valley. So after that, we tried to formulate public proposals, not only for women's issues and topics, but for the social problems in the area in general. And because we realized that it's really difficult with a very, low and poor budget the local authorities have to make some changes, despite that people in the area have a lot of social needs. In that moment, our attention has turned to the European funds as a potential source of funding for projects that can address social problems in regions undergoing energy transition, as Jiu Valley, and not only for women, but also for other categories like children, the elderly, people with disabilities, people with specific conditions like and problems like alcoholism and drug addiction. And what we did was to work together to some proposals, some amendments we made to, because in that moment, these territorial plans for just transition were opened to public consultation. We transmitted to the Ministry of European Investment and Project some proposals to include a gender perspective, but also to address more directly some social problems in regions like Jiu Valley. You can see on the screen two examples of our proposals in order to have gender equality more present in these territorial plans for just transitions. And the ministry accepted all our recommendations and changes in this just transition territorial plan for just transition. It was a success from our part. And the next phase of our advocacy campaign was to work on the just transition operational program. Because after a few months, this also was publicly put in a public consultation. And in our document that we submitted to the ministry, we call attention to the fact that the approach of the ministry, according to which the transition will only be just if it leads to investment and sustainable development of entrepreneurship, was not sufficient. In order to be truly just, it must also include people who, for one reason or another, cannot be employed under current conditions, such as women with small children, because they cannot rely on the care infrastructure, people with disabilities from whom no specific employability measures are included, people with various illness and addictions that were also caused by the socioeconomic context. We also stressed in our document that the just transition must address women's issues because they have major difficulties as a result of insufficient care infrastructure, caring for children, but also for ill, for people with disabilities and people with different illness and problems of the elderly. And in this stage of our advocacy campaign, we didn't have so much success as the first stage. We focused a lot on the indicators. I mean, it's not enough to have these social problems recognized in the text of the program, but it's also important to have the indicators for the implementation of the programs. But the ministry refused to integrate the proposed indicators, arguing that the social dimension is addressed in other operational programs, such as health, education and employment, inclusion and social dignity, or regional programs. After the ministry's refusal to integrate our recommendations, we sent also a memo to different European institutions to bring to their attention the refusal of our government to include the social component. And even if these indicators at the end were not included in the operational program, we saw some changes from that moment. We note that the funding that opened this year had a greater concern for social aspects in the projects to be approved and implemented. And we believe that our actions have been important and have been able to raise awareness among policymakers about the social component of just transition and especially on gender equality. We are now in the second year of implementation of the project. We are working on the call for projects launched by the ministry. And we already made two concrete proposals on gender mainstreaming the grants allocated from the Just Transition Funds. And these proposals are not only regarding the gender equality, but as I already told you, they are about, they concern broader social categories. So at the end, you have some useful links, not only a link to the research in English we made in the project, but also a short movie we also made in our projects. And I will give you all these links in the chat, so you can access them. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's been interesting because I wanted to tell everybody that maybe I'm a bit biased because I've been part of the work, but you put a big picture with me and you also at the event. So I think it's obvious by now. Maybe just to say a word of my experience with this work is I do remember at the exact event where the picture was taken at the launch of the research, there was an older lady who said that for her, it's really interesting that it's the first time that she hears people talk about women in Jiu Valley. And I think this is the case for many coal regions, I would guess. So yeah, that's one of the things that stuck with me from that that event for sure. What I wanted to ask you is, you talked a lot about what you managed to do last year. Maybe if you want to talk a bit more about what you're doing this year, and maybe also if you have any plans for next year, I'm not sure.
Yes, so this year the Ministry of European Investments and Projects launched two grants to call for projects for small and medium-sized enterprises. We asked, and it was accepted this time, to award some extra points for the employment of women in these projects, because these grants are allocated for enterprises to extend their activities. And at the beginning, there was no point, extra point for social categories and for the employment of women, and we changed this. What we asked for and was not accepted was the inclusion of additional economy activities, activity codes, because these grants are allocated for only for some economic activities. And in this list, there are no activities regarding social or health infrastructure, unfortunately, because they consider that this infrastructure, and not only infrastructure, but also services in the social and health sector, they consider that European funds are allocated through other operational programs. But for us, it's important to also to have the possibility for the applicants to have this access to these funds, because these funds are especially dedicated to these counties affected by just transition. And for example, in some of these counties, people have a worse condition in when it comes to health, for example. So it's important to, but they didn't accept this. And we are going to continue with our requests. And as I told you on the screen, this is not a race, it's a marathon. We think that step by step, we can, you know, convince more people that this part of the social component of the just transition, it's really important, and gender equality is really important. And for the next year, this is a very difficult question, because in this moment, the Ministry of European Investments and Project, they are keep launching grants, and they are keep launching a call for projects. And we are thinking in to be involved in these grants, especially when it comes to work with public administration, because I think they can really make some important changes with these European funds. But in this moment, it's, I don't know, it's difficult to say exactly what we are going to do.
Thank you so much, Tudorina, for sharing the experience that you had in Romania working on this. I think it's a really good example of partial success, let's say, not a full success. Not everything is perfect, but a lot of progress has been done. And I think it's important to highlight that. And it's important to highlight it at the national level and also at the European level. Maybe give ideas to other countries, maybe give ideas to other campaigners, and so on. So I think this whole story is really important. So thank you very much for that. But and moving on, I would say that the story of Romania is highly connected with the Just Transition Fund. So how would a country go forward in looking at this connection between gender and just transition in without access to the Just Transition Fund? So that's why I ask Alma to please try to tell us the story of Bosnia and Herzegovina and her work.
And how it doesn't work here. thank you, Dan, for the invitation, and thank you to Dorina and Jill for your presentations. I'm glad to hear that with conclusions, we are overlapping, I would say, and we have also kind of similar recommendations. So I'm kind of glad to hear that during your presentations. So I will try to present you some of the main findings of the study I done for National Democratic Institute. Like it was done, this study on gender responsive green transition in Bosnia and Herzegovina was done early this year. Research was finished. And also I will give you some of kind of lessons learned from the field, let's say, from my experience of supporting different initiatives of citizens, and what can be improved, at least some conclusions, so not to end up in some dark gray zone. So regarding the research, while designing the study, we tried to look upon all of the five pillars of the Sofia Declaration and try to connect those pillars to, let's say, women issues or women question, as you wanted. Also, we mapped main stakeholders and we went to legal framework regarding just transition let's say gender in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Problem is, as you said, funds in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Sofia Declaration was signed, I think, now 3 years ago or almost 3 years ago, and we still don't know much what does this mean, what funds we will get how we need to use these funds. Small-scale qualitative research was also done for the purpose of the study. And when you are listening to citizens, they are totally confused. They say that the process is not transparent enough. They say that they are missing one information point where they can find all the information regarding the transition. They don't even know where to start to find information. This is not even the, I would say, even main topic in the media. All the conversation is limited to the, let's say, politician circles and some CSOs, not all the non-governmental organizations, because the discussion stays in these, I would even say, closed circles. Now we have a bit of events that are opening the talks about just transition, and it's mostly connected to the, let's say, concept of citizen energy and energy poverty. So just to give you a bit where we stand currently in Bosnia and Herzegovina. I would open my presentation with one quote from the qualitative research. One decision maker during the in-depth interview said, like, men deal with the industry and energy, and you can see women only dealing with environmental problems. Women are mostly mentioned when it comes to energy poverty, unfortunately, in Bosnia and Herzegovina. But you will see in the front lines of the almost all environmental struggles in Bosnia and Herzegovina, you will see the women in the front lines. A lot of women are leader of those initiatives or struggles. So we see like that we are not represented in the processes or in the policy development processes, or within, I would say, even these diplomacy circles that at least to me seems that transition is in Bosnia and Herzegovina now developing only in this regard. So regarding the other findings, as I say, citizens do not have enough information about the transition, but they know a lot about the environmental problems. But they do not connect transition and environmental problems. Or what is even more interesting is when you ask them about the concept of citizen energy, they are not familiar with it. But when you describe, energy communities, for example, they would say, I'm familiar with that. So it's a bit, to me at least, it was a bit like, wow, we need to explain basic concepts. It seems like that regarding the transition in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Citizens feel like this process is something that is happening in certain circles, and that they are not part of this circle, and that the transition will just go through some circles and that they will not be included. They say that they have more existential problems to think about than to think on the green transition. So they kind of connected to the elites, I would say. And that's something that all citizens should benefit from. And that's why we have a lot of space to work with the general public, with the education and informing the general public. Additionally, we still, like recently, we got this set of energy laws in Bosnia and Herzegovina, so-called energy laws, but still we miss a lot of bylaws. So we cannot use even energy communities, let's say, as a mechanism of combating, not combating, but as a mechanism of decentralizing energy sector. Also, There is a big fear of corruption due to previous case related to overextensive construction of small hydropower plants in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And that is one big lesson learned, at least here, because under umbrella of renewable green energy, we got this, as we call it, tsunami of small hydropower plants, meaning that on every 4 kilometers of every river in Bosnia and Herzegovina, we would have some kind of barrier. And currently, 120 small hydropower plants produce only 2% of the renewable energy and electricity. And when you face this to the basic human right to water, then, and most of these communities that the small hydropower plants were planned to build, they still don't have access to clean water. So I'm kind of afraid what these transition and all the forms that transition could have if it's not guided properly. And that is something that we learned, at least in Bosnia and Herzegovina, how everything can go wrong, even under some, good effort to use more clean energy, for example. Here it's important to say that around 15,000 people works in energy sector in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Miners are the least part of these 15,000. I think there are only 4 to 5 thousand miners in this employment chart of the energy sector. And most of those people live in rural areas. And that's why we kind of especially took in our analysis, we tried to took to analyze what do women need in rural areas under the argumentation that most of the energy workers come from the rural areas. So that's why we need, let's say, to invest in those areas. Not only because of the men from the energy sector, but also because women in the rural areas are facing even more challenges, as Tudorina also mentioned, regarding social services. For example, we propose to invest more money in public infrastructure in rural areas and kind of connected with just transition. I'm trying just to give you kind of a view where our research took us. It was not only about energy sector and energy transition. And as also Jill also mentioned that at the start, it's not the transition of one sector. It needs to be done in every sector. And we need to look in every sector how we can have this just transition. But as a story usually goes, without government support, we cannot do anything. And I think currently Bosnia and Herzegovina describes this well. Although on the level of local self-governance, many politicians are open to start with certain projects. That's why we, for example, recommended incentives for the women to be done differently. For example, incentives for the women in rural areas that have rural businesses that will inherit the business in rural areas. And for now, you have these codes in the budget of local self-governance, so we can use already existing funds. They are not, we need more money, to be honest, but still let's, at least at the start, let's try to work with funds that are already there. So in that manner of what can be improved, We sticked a lot to that sustainable and rural development, because even by the OECD definition, Bosnia and Herzegovina is a rural country with 61% of people living in rural areas. So we proposed the establishment of thematic sub-programs for supporting women in rural areas, enact specific measures for tourism, agriculture, rural development, and also fostering supporting initiatives for the protected natural areas, because most of the women that are involved in environmental struggles, they are asking to protect nature and to have more of protected areas where they are living, and they want, through these protected areas, they want to show, like, we are not against development, we want to protect the nature and to develop some businesses that are in line with the protection of the nature. So we were all around the place with our research. Also, agriculture sector is very important, also because in Bosnia and Herzegovina, it's one of the rare economy sector that still works. Also, tourism is a sector that has even 10% of, like in a yearly, it rises for 10%. I don't know, I'm already took too much of your time. I will conclude just a second. And yes, one of the, and in general, issue of energy poverty is very problematic in Bosnia and Herzegovina. For example, 72.9% of households heat only one room in the facility or in the house of the people in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And this is also a space where we can be part of this policy development, either as a woman or as any other vulnerable group, because this is, regarding the incentives, very important to include those groups when you develop policies that will, at the end, bring the money to the groups that you want to support. And as I would conclude with also one quote from one fellow citizens that said, the green transition will happen with us or without us. Now the question is whether we will manage to process and to do it the way we want. Okay.
Thank you, Alma. Well, thank you. I do think that you painted quite a grim picture in some ways, but at the same time, it's worth it to think that maybe there are other countries who have similar situation, but they don't benefit from projects such as yours. So I think that's really important to keep in mind. It's in the worst case scenario, it's a very good start. So I think we should be happy about that. You talked at the beginning about the way of recommendations that you had in your study overlapped with Tudorina's and Jill's comments. Do you have one in mind that you think is most crucial to empowering women's position in the just transition process?
Yes, I would say it's the most important is to ensure that women's voice is recognized and that they actively participate in the development and the implementation of the all policies and projects related to just or green transition. Because without us, I know this because I look to such a large number of development policies in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And only if they include women or women position or women issue, it's like this small paragraph. And it's such a general paragraph. It's not about going into details and to see what policies do they need and how can women benefit from this. So as a tools, we can use all the available participatory mechanisms to ensure this. And also what my fellow colleagues mentioned before, gender responsive budgeting is also one of the tools. So I would finish with this.
Thank you so much, Alma.
Welcome.
I think we can get a question if we have from the public. If not, if any of you have any question towards the other panelists, that's also welcomed. If someone wants to ask something to the other speakers, that would be interesting. So I will give you a few seconds to think about it. Jill, please.
Yeah, I'd like to come back to this really interesting idea of gender equality not being a race, but a marathon, and the steps that you see as being essential. So can you say a little bit more about how we manage these steps? You know, what do we have in terms of short-term objectives, medium-term, long-term? How do we manage the process?
Okay. Yes, I think in short term, it's important to discuss, as we are doing here, and to discuss with all the people involved. I mean, with politicians, with public administration, with NGOs, and to form like a critical mass regarding this. It's very important. I think it's an important step. You cannot do some changes if people are not convinced that this is important. And why we work so much on the funds, because with money, you can also promote some really important steps. As I told you in my presentation, we realized that even if the public administration, the local administration is open to work in this, with their budget, it's really difficult to change things, because we are talking about poor municipalities. They don't have budgets for other issues. So it's also, I think, yes, it's also a question of priority. They don't consider this to be a priority too, but still they have really really complex problems when regard to fund different programs. So this is why we try to work where we really can make some change in the grants the European Union is allocating. So this is an important step too. And I think we somehow managed to gender mainstreaming this operational program. I mean, from someone who is looking for the first time in this operational program in Romania, it would be like a surprise to find so many references to gender equality. But yes, it's also important to have this in the indicators. So this was like not okay not to have indicators. And we focused a lot on the social component. And I'm sure you know, but I want to say that when you don't have social services or good health services, who is doing this work? I mean, who is doing the unpaid work? Are women in families? They are taking care of children. They are taking care of people with disabilities, with old people. So this is why we consider that this social infrastructure and social services are so important for the just transition. Because from the research, we found out that in Jiu Valley are women that cannot work because they need to take care of their small children. So they cannot be part of this transition on the labor market because they don't have services for their children. They also want to migrate abroad or to other cities to work, and they cannot do that. So this is the situation. I don't know if I answered your question. I mean, I tried. I know it's really difficult and I don't have the answers to all this.
Jill, do you want to say something?
I don't want to ask all the questions, but I also have a question for Alma, if that's okay. I was so interested in the emphasis that you put on the voice of citizens, and especially in this case, women citizens. How do we move to a genuine input on the part of these women instead of just having a consultation which is just there for show?
Thank you, Jill, for the question. And usually people will say like NGOs or civil societies should have more active role in consultation process, and kind of took this common language and put it in the policy language or bureaucratic language. But I think we need institutions in this process. Representative of the institutions who are conducting the development of certain policies, so it depends which level of governance, should go into the, for example, rural areas and collect those opinions of their citizens. What do they need? Because I remember reading also of different strategies where people in one village, women would tell me like, okay, Alma, we need, I don't know, certain equipment, so we want to produce certain product. And I looked into all of these strategies and you cannot find, and it was really something cheap and something that could be easily done, let's say it like that. So somebody is not listening to the people. And that's why I think this must be part of the institutionalized, because, you know, with every comment and every process that we have that is outside of the institutions, usually they don't take this into account, unfortunately. Although, I don't know, a charter on local self-governance will say like that cities and municipalities should take even non-formal participation into account when developing policies and so on. What we as practitioners or part of CSOs can do is help into translation this bureaucratic language. This is big obstacle for the participation, not only of women, but also other vulnerable groups. But as I said, usually, at least in Bosnia and Herzegovina, non-governmental sectors faces many challenges. If they don't get funds for the next year, then you will also lose support of certain people in the field that are supporting, for example, women. So I would say participation gives us good framework to do this, but the other side needs to take this seriously into account. Unfortunately, when we leave it like for them to pick up, then they will not listen. Maybe together with this process to have strong media campaign, then they like politicians don't like it, because sometimes this means that they will lose the votes. So we need to play on different fields, I would say. Translate, work with media, work with citizens, and negotiate that this participation process become obliged part of policy development.
Thank you, Alma, for your reply. I think we are moving close to ending, and maybe just a word as a vague conclusion, I would say that at least for me, since the first time I thought about working on this, which is something around 3 years ago, I didn't find a lot of studies and publications on this and people working on this. So and now looking for people to participate in this webinar, I thought it's not going to be a lot of people I could ask. And then I realized it kind of was. Some people that I had no idea are working on this. So I think in this regard, the future is brighter, at least. So yeah, maybe we can take this on a positive note and think about how this topic is growing in the future and how hopefully we won't talk about just transition without talking about gender dimension and how women are included in the process. Thank you so much for participating today. It was a lot of fun, and hope I will see you again soon.